touched. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. God is so very good to us, the rich blessings of God, and I'm so very blessed. I don't know about you, but I'm a blessed person tonight, and I know you are as well. What a distinct honor it is to be here tonight and to teach the Word of God here on this Wednesday night. I am so very honored that Pastor would have the confidence in me to be able to stand before you tonight. Amen. I won't delay, but I will hasten to the Word of the Lord tonight. Proverbs chapter 4 and verse 23 is where we will begin. Proverbs chapter 4 and verse 23, it says, "Keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. Keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life." God has been dealing with me for a little while now about the heart. And I just want to share and teach, treach, whatever you want to call it tonight, what God has been dealing with me on. And my title is, "Keep Thy Heart." Keep thy heart. Amen. Why don't we go to the Lord one more time in prayer. Heavenly Father, I thank you for your goodness. I thank you for your rich mercy, your grace. Lord, we're so very undeserving of what you have done for us. We're so very grateful. Lord, I pray right now, Lord, that your mercy would flood this house. Let your anointing flood this house in the name of Jesus. I pray that the seed that is sown find fertile ground in the hearts of your people tonight. And I pray that you would anoint my lips of clay in the name of Jesus. And everybody said amen. You may be seated. It is only about the size of a human fist, but the heart is the only muscle in our body that never rests. It's always working. It's always beating. And its perpetual motion keeps us alive. The main function of the heart is to act as an engine that allows our body to perform its functions. And oh, what an incredible engine it is. It beats an average of 75 times a minute, 40 million times a year, and 2.5 million times in a 70-year lifespan. At each beat, the average adult heart discharges about 4 ounces of blood. This amounts to 3,000 gallons a day, or 650,000 gallons a year, enough to fill more than 81 tanker trucks of 8,000 gallons each. It is a marvelous muscle that can keep on beating automatically, even if the other nerves in your body are severed. It recognizes that the rest of your life depends upon it, and so it cares for itself, providing precious nutrition to itself before supplying blood to the other parts of the body. It has an amazing ability to change and adapt, to be flexible in its environment, to remain supple, and to correct dangerous situations. It is not unheard of for a heart to create new arteries or to naturally bypass old arteries that have become hopelessly blocked. And if you have not already realized it, the physical heart that beats within your chest tonight is the very center and fountain of your life. From it, everything else flows. The blood circulates into every other part of your body because of your heart. You continue to live, breathe, think, and function because of the life that flows from your heart. Everything about your life depends upon your heart, and without it, nothing else works. There are over 854 references to the heart in the Old Testament alone. However, in more than 300 cases, it has a spiritual significance rather than a physical connotation. In Hebrew thought, the heart of a man is much more than just the marvelous muscle that supplies your body with the essential substance of life. It is the spiritual center of a man. The heart governs the actions of the man, his character, his personality, his intellect. His thought processes, his dreams, and his aspirations are all governed by the heart. all of the issues of life, the writer of Proverbs said, flow out of the heart. And so the heart controls and gives character to all that we are and all that we do. It is the seat of the will, the source of all evil and good qualities and behaviors. From the fountain of your heart, your whole life is influenced. If the heart is filled with hatred, so the man is filled with hatred. If the heart is filled with deceit, so then the man is filled with deceit. And if the heart becomes bitter, it poisons the whole of life. And if pride rules the heart, then pride rules the life. If vengeance or retribution consumes the heart, then it controls the whole of life. Quite simply, a man is what his heart is. And if the heart is dead to God, then nothing in him is alive. And if the heart is right with God, then all of his life and living is right with God. At the deepest level, all of your life is guided and directed by your heart. Out of the abundance of the heart, your life is influenced. Because of this, the heart is the focal point of God's dealings with his people. It is where God meets us. It is where God appeals to us. And it is in the heart that men either accept the approach of God or he denies and rejects the approach of God. And the problem is that the heart of mankind has been marred by sin. It is inherently wicked because of the nature of Adam and because we are born under the curse of sin. Everything in our life is contaminated by our heart. Our heart would rather follow after evil than good. The character of a man is naturally sinful. It is an inherited nature that poisons our heart. And from those bitter springs, everything about our lives is affected. The prophet Jeremiah said in Jeremiah chapter 17 and verse 9 that the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? It is the common theme in Scripture. The heart is presented as being the very root of men turning away from God. Men say in their heart that they do not need God, and thus they turn away from him. And the pride of their heart deceives them, and they follow after sin, and they forget in their heart the wonderful works that the one true God has done in their life, and they go chasing after false gods. Over and over and over and over again, the issue resides in the heart. The only solution that we find to the problem is for God to give man a new heart. As a matter of fact, the greatest realization in the Old Testament is the understanding that man needs a new heart. David cried out in Psalms chapter 51 and verse 10, "Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me." After noting the desperately wicked condition of the heart, Jeremiah shared a prophetic promise from God in Jeremiah chapter 24 and verse 7 when he said, "And I will give them an heart to know me, that I am the Lord, and they shall be my people, and I will be their God, for they shall return unto me with their whole heart." It was God's desire from the very beginning to establish within man a new heart that would seek after him, a heart that would know him, a heart that would return to him and be reconciled to fellowship with him. And this was God's supreme desire for man under the inspiration of divine anointing. The prophet Ezekiel looked ahead in time and he said in Ezekiel chapter 36 and verse 26, "A new heart will I give you, and a new spirit will I put in you, and I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you an heart of flesh, and I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and ye shall keep my judgments and do them." And that, my friend, is the heart of the gospel. A man named Jesus came and he lived and he died and he was buried in a borrowed tomb and he rose again on that third day, and he did all of that so he could create in you and a new heart and fill you with his spirit. Hallelujah. Aren't you thankful for the cross? Aren't you thankful that that man, Jesus, came and he bore all of your sins on that cross? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. And he did it all so he could create in you and I a clean and new heart. and fill us with His Spirit. That is what salvation is about. It is the answer to David's prayer. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. When you repent of your sins and you're baptized in the name of Jesus and you're filled with the gift of the Holy Ghost, God creates in you a clean heart. He exchanges that old, tainted, hard heart for a new, tender, right heart. And He fills you with His Spirit and He renews in you a right spirit. It is that Spirit that works within you, that empowers your new heart that God has created to pursue godly things instead of carnal things, to strive after the will of God rather than every whim of the flesh. And that is why Romans says that it is in the heart that you believe unto righteousness, that you obey from the heart, and that in doing these things the love of God is shed abroad in your heart. Because what God does in your life, it all starts from your heart. It is a change of heart. It is a heart surgery, if you will. And God removes that heart that was tainted by Adam's sin. And He creates in you a new heart, a new will, new desires, a new character, and a new nature. All of that flows from the heart. That's why Paul said in Ephesians that we do the will of God from the heart. Because the heart is the source from which this new life in Christ flows. If you want to serve God, you need a new heart. If you truly desire to walk after Him, you need a new heart. Amen. If you want to live a pleasing God, you need a changed heart. You must let God create a clean heart within you. And every man that comes to God in repentance and obeys the gospel is made into a new creature in Christ Jesus. A new creature has a new heart. And the new heart desires after God instead of the carnal things of this world. One of the leading killers in our world today is heart disease. A diseased heart is a dangerous thing because the heart finally succumbs to the corrupting influence that is degrading its performance. Your whole life is interrupted. Everything comes to a screeching halt when the heart stops performing. And the scary thing about heart disease is that you can have it and not even know it. The first indicator that many people ever have is that they have a problem with their heart is when their heart falters and creates a dramatic medical emergency. And the heart disease is a subtle thing. It does not develop quickly. It does not make its presence known until it starts doing damage. Heart problems develop so slowly. They are subtle. They develop so slowly that in order for the doctor to have a proper perspective of the problem, he needs to compare the changes at yearly, not daily, not weekly, but yearly intervals. And it takes a year for significant change to be noted. Let me share a spiritual truth with you tonight. Much of the scripture focuses on the presence of spiritual heart disease. It is the condition of a heart that begins to turn a person away from God, away from the things of God, and away from the blessings of God. It is a condition that endangers the very spiritual life that God has placed within you. It threatens the very nature of your walk with God. It robs you of spiritual peace and the security of walking with God. And just like natural heart disease, it develops slowly. You see, the spiritual always will mirror the carnal world, the physical world we live in today. Rebellion begins to take hold in the heart. Pride begins to flatter the heart. An individual begins to do what seems right in his or her eyes in their heart. They begin to let human reasoning overwhelm the gentle voice of conviction, and heart disease begins to take hold of the new heart that God has created within you. And bitterness takes time to get a grip of the heart. It doesn't happen fast, but when it does, it chokes the very joy out of life. And unfaithfulness takes time to overwhelm a person's convictions, but it does not happen quickly. But when it does, it undermines the very essence of godly living. It takes time for a spirit to become lukewarm. That which once burned brightly doesn't lose its glow quickly. But given time, the cold fingers of spiritual death begin to creep into the soul. It takes time for a heart to become hardened to the presence of God. The process that turns a heart away from God is a slow process. And if we're going to preserve this new heart that God has placed within us, then we have to heed the words of our text. Keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it flow, for out of it are the issues of life. If your heart becomes overwhelmed with pride or lust or bitterness or malice, then the whole current of your life will be tainted and affected. If you allow those things into your heart, even for a short time, then your character, your conduct, and even your sensitivity to the will and the ways of God are profoundly affected. So we must guard our hearts. We must keep it. We must protect it. We must shelter it and continually ask God every day, renew our heart. Renew us. So God, we understand tonight that it's your Spirit that renews us day by day. And God, we ask that your Spirit would renew our heart day by day. Because God, we understand that there is a thing called spiritual heart disease. And if we do not guard our heart, it'll begin to take place in our life. To keep the heart means that we strive to shut out everything that is opposed to God. God is a jealous God, and He will not share the throne of your heart. You can't serve God and serve the world at the same time. And you can't serve God and serve the lusts and the whims of the flesh at the same time. When Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 6 and 12, all things are lawful unto me, but all things are not expedient. All things are lawful for me, but I will not be brought under the power of any. He signified that he was keeping his heart diligently, that he was being careful not to let anything gain the place of his soul that belonged to God. There are things that I could do, he said, and that I don't do. Because I refuse to be brought under their power. I refuse to yield to their influence. You see, if I placed a very small object in front of my eye, it is sufficient to shut out the light of the sun. You see, the littlest things placed right to our eyes can block the whole of our vision. Paul recognized that there are some insignificant pursuits of life that if I'm not careful, can block out the will and the purpose of God for my life. He said, I could take up those things, but I refuse to do so because something in it might take root in my heart. And I cannot afford to jeopardize my heart. And Paul understood that he must guard his heart because it is at the heart. It is in the heart where a man begins to turn away from God or he begins to turn to God. Keep your heart with all diligence. To keep your heart with all diligence, it means that you pay close attention to the direction in which you are moving. If we aren't careful, the things of this world can gain a hold of us. And Paul said in Colossians chapter 3 and verse 2, set your affections on the things above, not on things on earth. Guarding your heart means that you have to guard your affections. Don't let anything in this world overwhelm your delight in heavenly things. After the wondrous deliverance of God, after He brought them into the promised land. God admonished to the people of Israel in Deuteronomy chapter 4 and 9. He said, take heed to thyself and keep thy soul diligently, lest thou forget things which thine eyes have seen, lest they depart from thy heart. And if you are not careful, you will forget what God has done for you, and the wonder of God will depart from your heart, and that is a dangerous place to be. If you want to keep your heart, you have to keep it in the Word of God. David said in Psalms chapter 119 and verse 11, he said, thy word have I hid in my heart, that I might not sin against thee. We must be careful to make sure that the living word of God is instilled in our hearts, line upon line, precept upon precept. Let us keep our hearts in conformity to the word of God. The Bible is not just a dusty old book that we keep somewhere in the corner of our home. Our heart is affected by those words that are written within it. And those words are life, they are liberty, and those words are hope. In those words, the heart is strengthened and faith is renewed and promises are secured. It is the Word of God that nourishes our soul and affects the whole of our being and the very mind of God. It is not enough just to hear anointed preaching on Sunday and Wednesday. Our heart needs to be regularly infused with the Word of God, and our heart needs to see itself reflected in the words and the will of God. It is contained within those pages of Scripture. It is the lifeblood that flows through our spiritual heart. The Word of God will change you if you allow it to. After the angel appeared to Mary and delivered to her the incredible news that the Savior of the world was conceived within her womb, Luke chapter 2 and verse 19 says that she kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. Listen to me tonight. Things that are not pondered in the heart are soon forgotten. We forget the goodness of God because we don't take the time to ponder it in our heart. We forget the righteous demands of godly living because we don't ponder them in our heart. We forget the things that God desires within us and the things that He has required of us because we don't take the time to ponder them in our hearts. Our hearts need to ponder the Word of God. To keep the heart means to maintain sensitivity to what pleases God and what does not please God. You can't keep your heart and dabble in sin. We have to renew it. We have to renew within our heart the realization of the sinfulness of sin. Sin separates us from God. Sin drives us from His presence. And each one of us would do well to consider the cost of sin. When you find yourself struggling with the weakness of the flesh, you need to remind yourself of the extreme price that was paid for sin. We need to be reminded of the absolute horror of the cross so that we recognize in our heart that the absolute devastation of sin. It is a dangerous thing to be callous to the effects of sin. What a dangerous place to be in. When participating in sin does not affect us, yet we can show up to church and think nothing's wrong. Sin is a deceptive thing. It appeals to our intellect and asks you to apply your human reasoning. It endeavors to convince you through a series of successive compromises that wrong is right, and man has the capacity to make anything seem to be okay, and he has the capacity to conceal himself in the truth of the matter and to convince himself that wrong is right. The writer of Proverbs recognized this, and he said in Proverbs chapter 14 and 12, "There is a way that which seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death." In another place he said, "There is a generation that are pure in their own eyes, and yet is not washed from their filthiness." You have to guard your heart from the deceptive nature of sin. You can't afford to be pure in your own eyes when you haven't been washed of the filthiness of sin. You might say, "Oh, I would never be deceived to such a degree," but you don't recognize how subtle and deceptive spiritual heart disease is. Have you ever pondered it? In a world that justifies perverted behavior and selective murder and inherent lifestyles, all you have to do is just walk into a store and look at the TV and you'll see the lifestyles that is put in front of us day after day after day, because if they believe that if they can just make you see it long enough in your heart, you'll begin to accept it. There is a large portion of the religious world that has totally lost sight of the absolute reality of sin, so we have to guard our hearts against that. the people of God have to guard our hearts against the agenda of this world and what it tries to place in our lives. That's why you need to read the Word of God. You need to see the judgments of God. You need to hear the condemnation in the voice of Jesus as He calls the Pharisees a generation of vipers. You need to be reminded of the severity of sin and the cost of sin. The psalmist asks in Psalm chapter 24 and verse 3, "Who shall ascend into the hill of the Lord? Or who shall stand in His holy place?" And the question was plainly answered: "He that hath clean hands and a pure heart." We have to keep our hands clean and our heart pure. A pure heart is the heart that hates sin. A pure heart grieves over sin rather than participating in it. A pure heart doesn't reason within itself, but it reasons with the Lord, who said in Isaiah chapter 1 and verse 18, "Come now, and let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins may be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool." A pure heart seeks to keep itself undefiled by sin. A pure heart endeavors to keep itself from the falling into subjection to sin. As I come to a close tonight here in my lesson, 1 Samuel chapter 16 and verse 7 says, contains this spiritual truth that man looketh on the outward appearance, but the Lord looketh on the heart. You see, we are prone to spend our time focused on the outward man, trying to make sure that we measure up and that we keep up our appearances. But God focuses on the condition of the heart. It's a shame, but it's true. We tend to neglect the heart because no one else can see it. We spend so much more time on the temporal things than we do the eternal things. We invest much more energy and effort into the things that don't matter in the grand scheme of life than we put into the heart. That is the very source of our life. And yet the Lord looks on the heart. He sees its thoughts. He sees its intentions. And He knows its desires, its designs. He beholds its motives and its motivations. And He deals with us accordingly. The very searching example of this is found in 2 Kings chapter 10 and verse 31. "But Jehu took no heed to walk in the law of the Lord, the God of Israel, with all his heart." You see, Jehu was notable because he launched a reformation in Israel. However, his reformation was incomplete because he failed to walk with God with all of his heart. He despised the worship of Baal, which Ahab had fostered, but he tolerated the golden calves, which Jeroboam had set up. And he put away some evil, but he failed to put away all evil. His was partial repentance. He sought to serve two masters. Mark this down. Repentance isn't just the turning away from the worst of sins. It is the forsaking of all sin. You can't hold anything back from God. Jehu went so far, but he stopped just short. He put away evil, but he did not do that which was good. He heeded not the law of the Lord to walk in it with all of his heart. He thought he could do enough just to get by, but he failed to keep his heart pure. And as a result, his half-hearted effort, the Bible says that Jehu caused Israel to sin, and the Lord began to execute judgment upon all of Israel. And later, through the mouth of the prophet Hosea, God promised to bring judgment on the house of Jehu and to seize the kingdom of the house of Israel, all because he stopped short of a pure heart. The wise man said in Proverbs chapter 23 and verse 7, "As a man thinketh in his heart, so he is." So my question to you tonight is, how do you think in your heart? How do you regard God? How much importance do you assign to His Word and His will and His authority in your life? Are you like Jehu? Are you just trying to straddle the fence? Have you tried to keep your heart pure while keeping one foot anchored in the world. We have to be careful. We better be careful. We better guard our hearts. Because you might be able to conceal a matter in your heart, but eventually your heart will betray you, because all of your life and living flows from your heart. So my charge to you tonight is, precious brother, precious sister, keep your heart. Why don't we all stand tonight? Why don't we all lift up our hands tonight? Heavenly Father, we thank you. You're good to us. Father, I pray right now that you would keep my heart, keep me pure. God, search my heart tonight, and if there is anything unpleasing to you, would you remove it and cast it far away from me? Because my desire is to draw closer to you. Let my heart be pure before you, God. Let there not be any pride. Let there not be any arrogance. Oh, God, search me. God, search me tonight. I lay it all down at this altar tonight. I settle it here tonight. God, I will give you my whole heart. God, I give you everything in me tonight. I surrender my will to you. I surrender everything to you tonight. Why don't we cry out to the Lord? Before you leave tonight, why don't you come to this altar and why don't you settle it tonight? Why don't you settle that matter of your heart? Why don't you get it right tonight? Hallelujah. Hallelujah.